public and private, that all share one common goal and purpose, and that is to make sure that the needs of the most risk and voiceless Iowans are not ignored here during the legislative sessions. We will remind our legislators that not only do many Iowans want our government to support our less fortunate citizens, but they also want one that is able to stand up to corporations who are cheating Iowa's businesses and taxpayers. Serving pie helps highlight these priorities in the process. Hopefully, we'll sweeten the message for legislators that we can grow our fiscal pie in a way that doesn't hurt low-income Iowans. This year, the Iowa Human Needs Advocates come to you with ideas on how to make a bigger fiscal pie by passing legislation that closes tax loopholes being abused by large out-of-state companies that will generate additional funds for our state. This is just one of our many recipes for our legislators to have success in this session, meeting Iowans' most basic needs, addressing problems with dental care, dental access for children, child care, earned income tax credit, ending predatory lending, funding our public health system, just to name a few. We have made a great little recipe book that is going to be part of the kit that every legislator will receive today. And with us, we have several voices who want to talk more about recipes for a better Iowa and what they have an experience to lead us to that conclusion. And with us today, we have Chris Grandstaff, who is a single father from Southern Iowa. We have Teresa Evans-Tomka, who owns a small business. And we have Teresa Scholl, who's with the public health nurse.
Good afternoon. I'm Chris Grandstaff from Madison County. I've been a single dad now for about 7 years. I have an 8-year-old daughter. Right out of high school, I went ahead and I joined the Air Force. I was there for 6 years. In 99, I got in a motorcycle accident, which broke my neck and had serious head trauma. And while my recovery, while I was in the hospital, my ex-wife, she filed for divorce. So as soon as I got well enough, I had to go basically get custody of my daughter and take her back. So I went back to work for 4 years after that, after my doctors told me, don't go back to work, you're only going to injure yourself more. I'm a carpenter by trade, and of course I went back, I re-injured myself. So at this time I can't do it, I can't work due to my physical injuries and the ongoing consequences of the brain injury. Doctors have pretty much told me they've done everything they can at this time, and all they're doing now is just, I'm dealing with pain management and basically ongoing checkups to make sure everything don't get worse. I've been enrolled in the Family Development Self-Sufficient Program for about 2 years. In the beginning, my focus was creating a safe environment for my daughter and myself. And the staff person that I was working with, she helped me apply for the Social Security disability, which of course I was denied. I was also having problems getting benefits from the VA. And now, when I had given up my FADS worker sheet, she's helping me reapply and try to get everything ironed out with both the VA and Social Security disability. I'm just trying to get to where I'm self-sufficient. And another way that the FADS program has helped me is she helped me. I was renting a house, like I said, in Madison County, and she's helped negotiate where I'm actually buying the house on contract terms, and it's saving me about $100 a month. So, but my budget is real tight. I get $246 from the FIT program and about $280 a month for food stamps, and right around $115 a month from the VA. So that's about $647 a month. And I, like most people, I, you know, I want to get off the FIT program, but I just, this time I can't until we're, like I said, the federal government has a 60-month limit. It's temporary for me and my daughter until I can get things worked out with Social Security and the Veterans Administration. An increase in FIP payment would really help me as I strive to create a safe and stable home for my daughter. I did apply for the LIHEP this year and received $378. It wasn't enough to get a delivery of propane, so the VA went in and another couple of $100 and filled my tank. I really don't know where I would be without the FAS program. It'd be great if more people were involved in FAS because it does really help people to change their lives and then for the better. Basically, thank you for the opportunity to speak today, and I hope my comments help people understand the difficulties of one family they have attempted to move out of poverty.
Owner, I'd like to be treated like all businesses selling services and products in Iowa. Closing tax loopholes gives small businesses like mine that do most of their business locally a chance to play by the same rules. Governor Culver called it a level playing field in his condition of the state address, and that's all I'm asking for, a level playing field. If a big company selling the same services or products as an Iowa business like mine can find a way to pay less tax on the same services or products, they have the ability to undercut the Iowa small businesses on price. That is not right, and it's unfair competition. And our tax system in Iowa should not promote it, but it does currently. I don't see how it's fair that a company can set up a separate company in another state, such as Delaware or Nevada, and use that company to shield money it makes in Iowa from Iowa's income taxes. I don't have that opportunity, and I shouldn't. I'm willing to pay my fair share of taxes. My competitors should do the same. Iowa's corporate income tax is supposed to collect tax based on profits from sales inside Iowa. We should make sure it does. I've seen reports by Iowa organizations that have been watching this issue. The Iowa Fiscal Partnership has reported that the state could receive $60 million to $100 million by plugging tax loopholes with combined reporting legislation. That's what the governor is proposing. How can we pass that revenue up? I have to balance my budget in my business, and so does the state of Iowa. Well, we've all heard about a big shortfall coming in the state budget, and I, for one, don't want to see services cut once again. The progress started should continue restoring services, but there is a long way to go. That's why the Iowa Human Needs Advocates are trying to make the pie bigger. We can help to do that by picking up money we are losing because our tax code isn't strict enough on big out-of-state companies. Our elected officials should know that even if the big businesses are arguing against this, there are many, many small business owners like myself who know the current system is not fair to us. Thank you.